What's up, Wisconsin? I'm Maggie Dawn. You are listening to The Maggie Dawn Show. Boy, it's good to be back in the chair. The vacation was very nice. I missed you all, though, very much. My biggest thanks has to go to Anya, who held it down with myriad guest hosts, myriad guests of the guest hosts.
A myriad of myriads,
myriad,
truly.
Yes. Lots going on. You also sat in the chair a couple of days.
I did, yeah.
Good Anya. So I literally mean good Anya.
There you go.
Anya. So thank you so much for doing all of that. And my big thanks to all of my guest hosts, City of Milwaukee Budget Director Nick Kovac, Attorney Liz Miles, State Representative Evan Goyke, Anya, of course, herself, as well as Matt Rothschild and Jim Santel. Am I forgetting anybody?
I think we've got them.
I think we got them all. My biggest thanks to everybody. Lovely to get away after all of this sea change for me. But here we are, a couple of really important things happening this week. Two tree things. And I'm super excited to be joined by Wisconsin Watch reporter Jack Kelly right at the top of the hour. Jack, thanks so much for joining the Maggie Dawn Show. Kudos on some really great coverage that's super important for all Wisconsin voters for this coming election cycle. Welcome.
Thanks, Maggie. Thanks for having me, and I appreciate the kind words.
Of course. I brought you on. You've been dropping lots of journalistic bombs, but the one that caught my attention, which also ran in the journal Sentinel, is about this artifact, I could call it maybe an artifice, that we elect local trial court or circuit court judges here in the state of Wisconsin. Tell us a little bit about what you discovered as you started to look into this, because 34 counties in the state, so 34 out of 72 counties, will elect a whole bunch of trial court judges. 56 circuit court races up for election, but only 10 of those are contested. Tell us more, Jack.
Yeah. No, you hit it on the head. Circuit court judges are likely the most powerful people in many counties that most voters have never heard of. They enjoy broad autonomy, broad authority. Some of my colleagues here at Wisconsin Watch, Jacob Resnick and Phoebe Petrovic, specifically have done some amazing reporting on the power of circuit court judges and sometimes how they seem to overstep the bounds of that power. Yeah, I mean, it was remarkable. There's 261 circuit court judges in Wisconsin. They collectively make up the bottom tier, the first tier of
the trial court judges.
Judicial. Yep. Yes, they're trial court judges of the judicial system. And they're incredibly important. They hear tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of cases on an annual basis. And yeah, as you said, just 10 of the 56 circuit court races on the ballot tomorrow are contested. Among the 47 incumbents running for another six-year term for this very powerful office, just four face a challenger. So it was pretty remarkable when I actually got down into the nitty-gritty of the numbers.
So we're joined this half hour with Jack Kelly, reporter from Wisconsin Watch. We're talking about circuit court judges in the state judicial system. They're the first level of judges or the bottom tier of judges. We're not besmirching that. It's probably, for most of us, the most important tier of judges, because if and when we all end up in some sort of legal processes, whether that be over speeding tickets, heaven forbid, a divorce, someone that we love dies and we have to get through probate, those sorts of, we'll all end up most likely at some point in time in some sort of legal process here in Wisconsin. And those cases are overseen by circuit court judges. This also includes, of course, criminal matters, which you touch upon a bit in your article. So these folks are the judges that will hear everything from a custody dispute, a divorce, landlord-tenant disputes, all the way up through really egregious, horrible murders. I just wanted to emphasize two facts that you mentioned, Jack. One is we've got 56 circuit court races across the state. Of those, 10 are contested, and of the incumbents, so of the 56, 47 include incumbent judges that are running, so judges that already sit on the bench. Of those 47 incumbent races, only four, are contested races. Jack, you talked to some experts. What does this say? The fact that very rarely is it that incumbent judges actually face challengers. What does this mean about the accountability of the legal system to voters and residents in Wisconsin?
Yeah. The experts that I talked to highlighted this point. Well, first off, we should say the legal opinions about the best way to select judges, whether it's elections, whether it's using some sort of selection committee, the jury is out.
Yes.
Pretty much no one thinks that there is a good way to select judges, I've discovered through this reporting process. But in terms of the accountability piece, they see elections as a way that's very difficult to hold judges accountable for their actions on the bench. And the reason for that is there is an information vacuum, right? Local media has been decimated. That is well documented and has become especially stark in the last 10 or 15 years. So voters are going to the polls. Oftentimes there's no challenger to these incumbent judges. So they're just being reelected by default. I mean, like to your point, 44 of the 40 or 43 of the 47 incumbents on tomorrow's ballot are going to be reelected.
No challenger. Yeah.
If they get just one vote, because that'll give them a majority, right? And so that is definitely a factor in it. And so it's interesting. The legal experts I talked to don't see this elections as a good way to hold judges accountable, because there is such a vacuum around the information related to how they act on the bench. There's just a void. There is not enough information about them as candidates.
Listen, folks, if you are wondering if you've got judges up for election in your county, you can preview your ballot and see the judges that may be running, including if there is a contested election. You can go to votedoc.org. You can call your county clerk's office. If you Google your county and preview ballot with your county name, it will take you to the right place. Again, lots of ways to get that kind of information. So go ahead and check those folks out. One of the things that I think is not only is there an information vacuum, there's also an incredible amount of pressure for lawyers not to talk smack about judges. I'll say this as a lawyer. Within the bar, meaning within those admitted to practice law in the state of Wisconsin, lawyers that appear in court know who the crappy judges are, but they're not going to come out and say that publicly in a way that the general public could actually benefit from that lawyer's insight. Because if you do speak, it's sort of, people talk about the blue wall when it comes to police. I'll call it the black robe wall. Judges, if you talk out of turn, even if that judge knows that the colleague that you're talking smack about is a crappy judge, they do not take kindly to that. And if you appear in court all the time as a lawyer and you criticize a judge openly in public, you will pay for that in later proceedings. We've had on my show judicial candidate, I believe it's for Branch 47 here in Milwaukee County, judicial candidate Rochelle Johnson Bent, so that she could share what her experience is and what her major reasons for wanting to become a judge are. What are some of the alternatives to this weird election system? And I also thought it was worthy of mention, Jack, you pointed out that this, in many states, sometimes they're partisan elections. We have nonpartisan elections here. So folks can't even get the benefit, if you consider it a benefit, of doing, like what side of the aisle generally the judge may be on. What are some of the options that we're seeing in other states and jurisdictions for picking judges?
Yeah, no, and you make a good point there, Maggie. The experts that I talked to raise similar points. If you are an attorney, let's say, for example sake, operating in Winnebago County in Wisconsin, and you want to mount a challenge to a sitting judge, you're going to do that likely at great personal, professional, and financial cost to yourself, because if you lose and then you have to conduct business in front of that judge or one of those that judge's colleagues, that is a huge mountain to climb. Getting to your question, so we have nonpartisan elections here in Wisconsin. Some places have partisan elections where candidates actually run as a Democrat or a Republican. And then a lot of states employ this system, which is called merit selection, or sometimes called the Missouri plan. And basically the way that this works is that You have a commission, and the makeup of the commission varies. Who appoints the members of the commission varies. The size of the commission varies. But the general idea is that there's a commission who reviews candidates and applications for people who want to be judges. And then they make recommendations to usually the governor in that state. And then the governor has to take those recommendations and pick from them to actually appoint people to different benches. And so, you know, the experts that I talked to said this is not without its flaw. Usually the system can be good at rooting out some of the, you know, so-called bad actors, or, you know, I think one of them described it as the worst of the bunch.
Yes.
It doesn't necessarily do anything in terms of judicial accountability once they're on the bench. But this is a system that became more popular with some states kind of during the 20th century, though has definitely lost some steam. One of the experts pointed out to me, there hasn't been a new state to, or there hasn't been a state to adopt this system in the last kind of 30 years.
Yeah, so, since like the 90s, I think it was the last time there was a merit selection process adopted by a state.
Right, right. Yeah. So it's interesting. It's, and you know, it's really fascinating. It comes back to this point I was making earlier, is that, you know, when you talk to the experts, they can't agree on one way to pick judges, but they can't agree on the idea that there is no one good way to pick judges.
We're going to talk more about this in just a minute. Can you hang on for another segment, Jack?
Yeah,
wonderful. Jack Kelly from Wisconsin Watch joining the Maggie Dawn Show, talking about the judicial elections on the ballot that you'll all see tomorrow statewide. We've got some 34 counties with judges up for election. That's 56 circuit court judges. Basically, my opinion, more important than the Supreme Court justices, although the media would likely tell you otherwise. We're going to talk more with Jack after these important messages. You're not going to want to miss a minute of this, because I'm going to tell you what I think is the best way to do this when we come back. You know I've got a solution. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Keep it locked, everybody.
Telling these tears, go and follow away, oh, may the last one burn into flames. Freedom, freedom, I can't move. Freedom, cut me loose, yeah. Freedom, freedom, where are you? Cause I need freedom too. I break chains all by myself, won't end my
Welcome back, Wisconsin. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show. I'm joined this half hour by Jack Kelly, reporter with Wisconsin Watch. He's been sharing a bit. His article came out, Wisconsin Watch, also run by the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, talking about the numerous circuit court judges that are up for election. Some 56 circuit court judges up for election. Just a handful of those in contested elections. In Milwaukee County alone, there's only one contested judicial election. That's in Branch 47. One of those candidates, Rochelle Johnson Bent, has been a guest of the show a couple of times. Here's what I think is really interesting. One, when you can't even get lawyers and other judicial experts to agree about how judges should be picked on the state level, it indicates that we've got a problem. Where does this sit, like, more broadly, do you think, Jack, in the declining levels of public confidence in our judicial system?
Yeah, I mean, the experts that I talked to, who are much better positioned to answer that question than I am, think, you know, it was kind of a smattering. People are losing faith in the judiciary, I think, because people are perceiving the judiciary to be more partisan. It's really fascinating how judicial elections even came to be, which were something that happened, you know, well, 150 plus years ago, as a way, because people actually thought it was a way to make judges more independent. They wouldn't be, you know, at the mercy of the governor or at the mercy of a legislature that might appoint them. They were elected by the people. Though initially they ran in partisan elections because that was the only kind of election that existed. Eventually they tried to insulate them more with nonpartisan elections. And it's kind of a pendulum that swings back and forth, right? Mm-hmm. I think we see this in a lot of areas. And I think right now the pendulum is very much at one end in terms of this perception of judicial independence and confidence in the judiciary. I think a lot of that is probably fueled by recent and more controversial decisions. I'm thinking of the U.S. Supreme Court overturning Roe v. Wade. I'm thinking here in Wisconsin of the Wisconsin Supreme Court, obviously has a new liberal majority, or I guess like relatively new, that happened back in August now, ruling the old legislative maps unconstitutional and right. being, somewhat aggressive in the cases that they've agreed to take in the way that it has remade political power. So I think it's a pendulum of things that swing back and forth. And I think that it'll continue. And it's just one of those things that'll happen so long as there is a judiciary.
Well, one of the biggest problems, and your article touches upon this, is, in my opinion, is the money in judicial elections. I think a huge step forward, no matter what the process for selection, has to involve strict and frankly extraordinary when compared to your typical partisan legislative and executive branch elections, very strict limits on spending in judicial elections. I would go so far as to advocate for effectively public financing that caps the amount that can be spent in a judicial election, and then really trying to encourage judicial candidates to engage in meaningful debates. It's interesting to me that, for example, the bar associations won't even really hold debates amongst judges. What they'll do is they'll have each judicial candidate and they'll ask them basically canned questions with no follow-up. And it's not really like the two candidates are even debating judicial philosophies, which I think makes it even harder for the public to understand. So the first thing I would do is look to some significant reform of how judicial elections, if you maintain an election process, are financed, because that's what's driving the partisanship, right? And I don't think partisanship and politics are helpful in any way, shape, or form within our judiciary. So that's my solution, is get rid of the private money in judicial elections, because we need independent judges. I also think using very rigorously policed selection or vetting committees in some way, shape, or form that are filled with a broad cross-section of lawyers in various practice areas that aren't just about those that make big political donations, are especially partisan, but perhaps lawyers themselves from the bar actually select the people that would be on the commissions that would do the screening of judicial candidates, because I've seen some really bad judges. I've also seen great judges in our circuit courts. It takes all comers, some good and some bad. Very briefly, we got just about under 3 minutes left. So I wanted to ask you, Jack, you also did some really good coverage, and we've talked about it here on my program, about these two referenda questions that are on the ballot tomorrow. Interesting referenda, because the state GOP gerrymandered legislature effectively tried to get these passed via legislation. The governor vetoed them. So now they're going the constitutional amendment route. What are the two amendments, and what's the controversy surrounding both?
Yes. So voters will have two questions before them. Question one asks them whether or not local governments should be able to accept private grant dollars, private grant donations, to help them pay for election administration, help them pay for election related costs. This is something that was very popular in Wisconsin after 2020. More than 200 municipalities got grants, though the five biggest cities, Madison, Milwaukee, Green Bay, Racine, Kenosha, got most of the money. And this constitutional amendment seeks to ban those grants and municipalities' ability to use them. Yep. The second question seeks to prevent people who are not election officials from conducting an election. It's very broad. It's very ambiguous.
I can't even figure out what the thing says. It's like, you can only help administer elections if you're lawfully permitted to do so, which I immediately thought, like, isn't that the situation now?
It is creating some confusion for sure. I mean, clerks have raised concerns about, like, could my city's public works department set the polling places up? Can I have the ballots printed by an outside group, which is very common? Can I have an outside group put together voting equipment for me. So the questions, question one is more clear about what its intent is. Question two is a little bit more broad. And this question two in particular is creating some confusion among clerks across Wisconsin about how it will affect their day-to-day. And of course, Wisconsin has a very unique election system where elections are administered by our 1,850 municipal clerks and our 72 county clerks. Obviously, this is something you're very, very familiar with.
Been there. Yep.
But it is creating confusion for them and how, you know, and what exactly it would mean and how the Wisconsin Elections Commission and courts would interpret the amendment and what the amendment meant. So there's definitely some uncertainty, particularly around question two, as, you know, we approach polls opening tomorrow morning.
Listen, Jack, it's really my pleasure to host you. I hope you'll come back to the show sometime. Just excellent reporting. We've been joined on the Maggie Dawn Show by Jack Kelly of Wisconsin Watch. Go check out his reporting. You can find Wisconsin Watch, https://www.wisconsinwatch.org. That's Jack Kelly. Go check out his reporting. Really great work, Jack. Thank you for everything that you do to help us be better voters and better residents and citizens here in the state of Wisconsin. Hope to have you back soon.
Thanks for having me, Maggie, anytime.
Absolutely. Next up, I've got Milwaukee County Comptroller candidate Liz Sumner. We're actually going to talk a little bit about Supreme Court Justice Brett Kavanaugh and his accuser, Christine Blasey Ford, when we come back after these important messages and the all-important farm update here on the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Back with more in just a moment. Thanks, Jack. Welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. You are listening to The Maggie Dawn Show. We were just joined by Jack Kelly, reporter for Wisconsin Watch. My thanks to Jack for joining us, talking about the judicial elections that you'll see on your ballot tomorrow, April 2nd. It is voting day. If you want to know where you vote, what's on your ballot, all kinds of good stuff, you can go to myvote.wi.gov. You can look at your particular sample ballot. If you put in some address information, it'll tell you exactly what it looks like, because everybody's is a little different depending on where you live. I always like to take a look at it ahead of time, especially for those referenda questions, because I want to read them. I want to figure out what the heck it all means, so I don't know what I'm doing when I get in there. And even I sometimes have been surprised. I didn't know that office was up for election. So now I have learned my lesson. I like to check it out ahead of time. Again, you can do that at myvote.wi.gov. joined this half hour by current Milwaukee County Board Supervisor Liz Sumner, who is running for County Comptroller. Welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show, Liz. Great
Thanks
to have
so
you.
Thanks so much for having me again.
Absolutely. Happy almost election day.
Yes. It's the final countdown.
For all those folks who haven't ever talked to a person running for office across the state, what is it like as somebody who's running? Are you just so ready for it to be done?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, the last like 2 weeks leading up to an election, always I can't really sleep much. So yeah. It just gets to the point where, I just want to get some rest.
Just want to sleep.
Yes, I need to know the outcome and then,
go the heck to bed.
Mm-hmm.
How is this different running for a countywide office as opposed to your supervisory election cycle?
Just the sheer number of voters. I mean, the size is I think, we all, like a lot of us live in Milwaukee County, and, you know that there are all these other municipalities. And then when you get in your car to go to them, you realize, it can be a good 45 minute drive to cross the county. So it's just the sheer number. You know, each supervisory district, I believe, is about 50 to 55,000 people. So you multiply that by 18. It's a lot of people. Yes.
So are you knocking a lot of doors?
I have been knocking a lot of doors. Yeah.
How's
especially
it going?
The last, like since the beginning of March, I've been out. It's going really well. I mean, you know, a lot of people don't answer their doors,
sure,
but I still feel like leaving literature, letting them know that you were there, is valuable. But I have had some really great conversations with people on the doors for sure. So
good.
That's
good.
Also great.
So tell everybody, what the heck is a comptroller and why is it important, not just in Milwaukee County, but in every county?
Yeah. Well, the comptroller is the chief financial officer of the county. And it's important because it's the person, it's the fiscal watchdog. So it is the person who watches the money that comes in and watches the money that goes out. All of the capital planning is done in the comptroller's office. And then all of the all the debt service, accounting, payroll, accounts payable. We also have the audit services division, and then also the research services division at the county. So it's, you know, it's really, I would say, the it's kind of the backbone that it, you know, helps make sure all of the other services that the county provides run smoothly and are properly funded.
How important is it for this chief financial officer for a county or any jurisdiction, city, town, village, everybody, wherever you live in the state, has got one, maybe two comptrollers that are responsible for the finances of the different jurisdictions that we live in? How important is it for that financial officer to have the right sort of experience and training to understand conflict of interest rules, those sorts of things?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's very important. As you know, I serve on the county board now. I'm the chair of the finance committee. I have a really great working relationship with our current comptroller and all the department heads underneath. He has served in the role for 17 years. So I think it's really important that someone that has a working knowledge of county finance, excellent relationships with county department heads and employees across the county, that someone that can come in and just transition smoothly is just going to be incredibly important. I mean, we have a, you know, $1.3 billion budget. That is a lot of money. And I think it's really important to have someone that's, you know, that has an idea of what is going on there.
Yeah, I talk often on the show about how these technical experts within local government, that their importance really can't be overemphasized. Mm-hmm. They're not the sexiest positions.
Not at all.
Right? Because it's, forgive me for saying this, it's bean counting. Yes. I was a chief legal, a paper shuffler, right?
Right, yeah.
But these experts.
Yeah, there's really, you know, there's no legislative power in it, really. But yeah, I mean, I think it's incredibly important.
It helps keep the legislature and the executive branch sort of coloring between the lines, if you will, right? Keeping the fiscal wheels on the bus, a bit of a watchdog. The same thing for these chief legal officer roles.
Right.
Super important. Just very briefly, I know you've been on before. Share with people a bit of your background and your qualifications for this job. Milwaukee County Comptroller.
Mm-hmm. So as I said, I currently serve as chair of the finance committee, work really closely with the current comptroller and the department heads underneath him. I also have an MBA from the University of Chicago with concentrations in finance and strategy. I'm a small business owner. I have owned a women's clothing store in Shorewood for 16 years. And then I have served on the Fox Point Village Board since 2015. So I have a good amount of municipal and county finance experience.
Thanks for that. Where can people find out more about you, Liz?
Mm-hmm. If they go to liz4mke.com, that's my website, and that has a bunch of background for me. And then also on social media, Liz Sumner for Milwaukee County Comptroller.
Wonderful. I think one of the things that folks can struggle with when we're dealing with these technical expert elected offices is, how do we vet people? My suggestion to folks is Google.
Yeah.
Like Google people's names.
Yes.
Now, you got to vet the source, right? If it's a person's campaign website, it's going to be all promotional, all the good things. But go ahead and read about folks. Your opponent has had some challenging headlines. Is there anything that you want to address specifically about your opponent's qualifications or lack thereof, or anything related to your opponent specifically for the comptroller's race?
I mean, you know, he doesn't really have a lot of experience in government. And I think it's just, it's a different animal than private financial experience. He also did serve on the county pension board when it was discovered that he had a familial relationship with someone that was receiving county pension benefits. He was asked to step down and refused. And I feel like, you know, it's just a violation of his fiduciary responsibility as someone who serves on the county pension board. And I think that that's worrisome. I think particularly for someone that's running for a position that really is the fiscal watchdog, you need you know, you need to have proven, I guess, morals.
Yes. I think, and again, not to hide the ball, folks that have listened know this. I was the lawyer for Milwaukee County on the pension board at the time that this conflict of interest came to light. I can't say any more strongly than this. It is a per se breach of a fiduciary duty to have an active conflict of interest, to be advised of that violation of your breach of duty of loyalty, and then refuse to step down. And in a jurisdiction like Milwaukee County that has had significant pension challenges, significant fiscal challenges, to see someone sort of flout those rules so extraordinarily and without any compunction was really deeply concerning to me as the chief legal officer of Milwaukee County. I wanted to ask you a little bit, well, best of luck tomorrow. Let me just ask you this. I'm always curious.
Mm-hmm.
How are you spending election day, Liz?
Mm, yeah, well, I'm going to wake up and go vote. I want to take my children with me, and so I feel like it's better to do it before school than after school. Yeah. So I am going to do that. Then going to do some canvassing. I know, you know, a lot of times people say canvassing on election day really doesn't matter, but I think it's it'll give me something to do to pass the time. And I think there are a lot of people that will get home from work and maybe not be motivated to go to the polls, or will have forgotten that there's an election, and just having that reminder at their door, you know, can be the impetus to get them out voting. So that's my plan. And then, of course, have, you know, my kids have a bunch of after school activities that I'm going to be running them around to. And then there are a lot of people having election night parties. And I think I am going to try to go to a couple just to congratulate people that I am confident are going to be victorious. And I would also like to celebrate as well. So that is my plan.
Best of luck to you tomorrow. Current candidate for Milwaukee County Comptroller Liz Sumner. She's a current Milwaukee County supervisor, also on the village board for Whitefish Bay.
Fox Point.
I'm sorry, for Fox Point. Mm-hmm. Thank you for the correction.
Mm-hmm.
Before we run out of time, I wanted to ask you, Christine Blasey Ford, who accused now sitting Supreme Court Justice Brett Kavanaugh of sexual assault, just released a book, and there has been all kinds of commentary about her, about her testimony before the Senate Judiciary Committee during Kavanaugh's confirmation hearings. Mm-hmm. I just thought you're relatively new to elected office, and you've served now one or two full terms.
Two
full terms as a county board supervisor. So you've been an elected official for 4 years.
Yeah, although I have served on the Fox Point Village Board as an elected official since 2015.
Okay,
yes.
So now we've got, let's see, that's
nine
years plus four at the county level. This all happened, you know, in 2018 while you were on the Village Board.
Mm-hmm.
What do you remember from her testimony and this controversy back in 2018?
I guess what I remember is relating. And I think that a lot of women out there can relate to being in situations that were incredibly uncomfortable with, you know, men who I think were exercising their physical power. And so I think that was, you know, I remember her being discounted and, you know, people not, and, you know, question, you know, basically saying that that couldn't possibly happen because they didn't think she was attractive or, just really not believing her. And, you know, that it was sort of like a, here we go again, kind of feeling.
Yeah. Sadly. So I think the relating to what she was talking about, as well as some of the challenges in her recall and when she chose to speak about it, all those things, only to the degree that you feel comfortable talking about it, you know, how do you, if that relates to you in your life, how do you talk to your daughter about those things? How do you approach those such difficult topics? Has what happened to Ms. Blasey Ford and the evolution of this issue over the last 5 years sort of changed your thinking about it?
I'm not sure. I think, you know, I keep thinking that things are changing and then I think situations like this happen and it makes you realize that they're really not. My daughter's young enough that I don't think, you know, we need to have a conversation about this yet. I do know that in the education system, they are addressing it much more and they are raising children of both of all genders, yes, to be more respectful of each other and to understand that no means no. And, you know, even if someone's in a compromised position or whatever. And so I think for me, that's reassuring that those conversations are happening, because they certainly didn't when I was being raised.
Yeah, it's shocking to me how predictable the responses are to women that come out publicly to accuse very high profile men of this kind of assaultive behavior. Mm-hmm. It is a script that I first saw play out with Anita Hill, mm-hmm, and Clarence Thomas. And it was this eerie echo to me, mm-hmm, watching the hearings for Justice Kavanaugh's confirmation. Very similar lines of attack. And, you know, there's bits and pieces of this every time a high profile man is accused. I think we're seeing it a little bit with Sean Combs, a.k.a. Mm-hmm. P. Diddy, right? Yeah. And folks attacking the motivations of the women that have accused him. Well, listen, Liz, I really appreciate your service to Milwaukee County. Thanks so much for coming on the Maggie Dawn
Show.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great to see you.
Heck yeah. Good luck tomorrow.
Thank you.
Maybe I will see you out at some of those watch parties.
That'd be great. I would love it.
The county needs you. That is candidate Liz Sumner up for Milwaukee County Comptroller. No matter where you live in the state, remember these technical offices, you go check them out at myvote.wi.gov so that you are the most educated voter tomorrow when you step, mm-hmm, into that voting booth. Yes, gotta do it. You can see your ballot preview and get the opportunity to research these candidates. Thanks to Liz. Good luck to Liz Sumner, Milwaukee County's next comptroller. Stay tuned, everybody. I will be back with some more thoughts on Christine Blasey Ford after these messages here on the Maggie Dawn Show. Welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. You are listening to The Maggie Dawn Show. I have got another great guest coming up at the top of the hour. The founder of Vote.org and Vote America, Deborah Cleaver, is going to be joining us. So appropriate coming up on Election Day, Anya. You're not going to want to miss our discussion with Deborah. I'm going to ask her a little bit about Christine Blasey Ford and her recollections from that time in 2018. I just want to address my views on this, because there's been all sorts of media takes on Christine Blasey Ford's memoirs. She just published a book. It's getting lots of media attention. She's been doing lots of interviews. If anybody that knows her is listening, have her come on the Maggie Dawn Show. 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842 if you'd like to comment on this. But here's what I said to people repeatedly back during Kavanaugh's confirmation hearings. And it is pretty simple. The standard of behavior and conduct for a U.S. Supreme Court justice is higher, in my opinion, should be higher than the standard of conduct and past behavior for any other office at the state or federal level. Why, do you perhaps ask? It's because they're appointed for life and they establish the law as a Supreme Court justice. Presidents have a max of 2 terms. They don't stick around for 30 years. Supreme Court justices do. They're appointed for life. And if we're going to disqualify or criticize candidates from Gary Hart to Al Franken, Bill Clinton, Donald Trump, for abusive or harassing behavior, my suggestion is that one who raises their hand to become a Supreme Court justice, as Brett Kavanaugh did, he was shortlisted by the Federalist Society. He agreed to be nominated. that you had better damn well expect the sort of scrutiny that he received. Notice I'm not addressing the truth or falsity of Ms. Blasey Ford's testimony. I believe her. I believe there is corroborating evidence. What one calls corroborating evidence, others call circumstantial. But when you have someone who, like Ms. Blasey Ford, was willing to endure that interrogation to come forward, where there is some evidence that does corroborate her account, this isn't a court of law. This is a confirmation hearing for individuals that sit and determine our federal laws, the rights and freedoms that we all should have guaranteed by our Constitution for the rest of their lives. So there isn't an evidentiary standard. I talk about the standard of conduct, as high as it possibly can ever be. But the standard of evidence is low. We're not talking about taking away Brett Kavanaugh's freedom. It's not a criminal proceeding. This isn't a beyond a reasonable doubt standard of evidence or burden of proof. It should be the lowest standard of evidence with the highest standard of conduct. Why, again? These people determine your rights and mine for the rest of their natural born lives on this planet. And we basically have no means to remove them. There hasn't been a Supreme Court effective impeachment of a justice. I don't know. Find out on you if you can. I have not in our lifetimes, not in over 50, 60, maybe 75 years. So here's what, based upon that standard, those two standards, right? The standard of conduct as high as it possibly can be. In other words, no even somewhat reasonable allegation of misconduct of this level should be permissible for a Supreme Court nominee. It should be disqualifying because there was de minimis corroborating evidence. Yes, de minimis, but corroborating evidence nonetheless. Highest standard of conduct, lowest burden of proof, lowest evidentiary standard. Here's why, when you look at the particular facts of Brett Kavanaugh, he, in my book, according to these two standards that I've articulated for you, he doesn't get to become a Supreme Court justice. The guy admitted he was a drunkard, that he has spotty recollections. Well, guess what? You don't get to be a Supreme Court justice. Thank you, Anya. The only justice to be impeached was Associate Justice Samuel Chase in 1805.
And he was still acquitted. Yeah.
So there's never been a Supreme Court justice ever removed by the impeachment process. This is why Clarence Thomas and Brett Kavanaugh in the world that I'm talking about don't become Supreme Court justices. Highest standard of conduct imaginable, lowest evidentiary standard, lowest burden of proof. Why those two things together? We're not talking about a liberty deprivation. We're talking about an elevation of power, reach, and influence that I think in many ways outstrips the very president of the United States. And you hold that power and you wield that influence for your entire life. If that's what you want to raise your hand to do, guess what? You better not have been a blackout drunkard when you were in high school and college. Because what? That's disqualifying. Because you can't say to a certainty that you didn't do what you were accused of doing. And I believe Anita Hill, too. Why do I believe? Because nobody's coming up with a story about a pubic hair on a can of Diet Coke. That just too specific. Highest standard of behavior and conduct imaginable with the lowest burden of proof. That is what it should be for Supreme Court justices. Applied without exception, regardless of party, regardless of policy, regardless of judicial viewpoint. I think that would result in better judicial candidates. I don't know about you, but I don't want a blackout drunk on the Supreme Court. And guess what? I couldn't be a Supreme Court justice because I got blackout drunk a couple of times in college. Not good. That's it. Sorry. When we come back, we're going to be joined by the founder of Vote.org and Vote America. We're going to talk about what actually drives voter turnout. You're not going to want to miss it. Joined by Deborah Cleaver, coming up. My thanks to Jack Kelly, reporter for Wisconsin Watch, and Milwaukee County Comptroller candidate Liz Sumner, my guest in this first hour of the Maggie Dawn Show. Keep it locked. News, weather, and sports coming up next here on the Civic Media Radio Network.